السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى أيضا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. صدق الله العلي العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher and protector. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders, brothers in Islam, first and foremost, it is incumbent upon all of us to thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of the blessings that He has bestowed upon us. The numerous blessings that Allah the Almighty, in His infinite greatness, He has bestowed upon us. And as Allah the Almighty says in the Noble Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. Indeed, even if you were to try to count the blessings of Allah the Almighty upon you, you would never ever be able to enumerate or count the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. So many blessings. If you were to look around us, if you were to look at ourselves, our life, every single thing, whether it be positive or negative, is a blessing from Allah the Almighty. It's a blessing from Allah the Almighty. And when I say negative, even if it be a sickness, even if it be a trial, even if it be a calamity, you might not understand it. We humans are futile. We are weak. We may not be able to understand the things that are happening behind the scenes. Behind the scenes. A trial may look difficult upon us and we may think, why is our Creator being harsh upon us? But Allah save us all. It is out of His kindness. It is because He loves us. It is to purify us. It is to prepare us for something great. And a good example to clarify that, as examples bring about clarity, you see, the story of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, just one point, but it is a gem indeed, which we need to contemplate and reflect on. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was crossing, when he was traveling from Palestine with his beloved wife Sarah alayhi salatu wasalam, they were crossing Misr, they were crossing Egypt. There was a ruler who was a dictator in that particular country at that time. And he was a pervert. He used to rape women. This was his thing. He had a fetish for raping other people's women. In other words, other men's wives, etc. So whenever a strange group or a caravan were to pass through the borders, the soldiers used to question the men of that caravan as to who the women are. If the women by any chance were their sisters or mothers, they used to let them go. But if that woman or those women were their wives or wife, then they used to take capture of them and take them to the palace for the king. So Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, We know such a great prophet, Allahu Akbar. His life is full of anecdotes and stories for us to derive lessons, Allahu Akbar. He's traveling with his beloved wife, Sarah alayha salatu wasalam. They come to the border now. Then the soldiers who are at the border, they question. Now Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, now this is, I don't want to go deep into the story, but then he says that when they question him, he does not reply as, this is my wife. He says, she is my sister. She is my sister. But he did not lie. He was intending that she is my sister in Islam. And also because he wanted to save his wife from the harm that is in front of them. So he says that she is my sister. But still, the soldiers were so fascinated by her beauty. Sarah alayha salatu wasalam was an extremely beautiful woman. They were so fascinated that they thought, we have to take this woman to our king, to our emperor. So they take the woman and go to the king. Now Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, perturbed, disturbed, he's upset. He doesn't know what's going to happen. Immediately he turns to Allah the Almighty in prayer. He takes takbir immediately. Allahu Akbar. He starts prayer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, this is the real slave of Allah. You are in a difficulty, you are in a trial, you are in a calamity. You immediately turn to Allah the Almighty. Now the soldiers are taking the woman and going to the palace. Allah the Almighty, in his infinite wisdom, because Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam immediately turned to him, oh my beloved slave, look at what's happening inside now. Allah makes the palace as if it's made of glass. As if it is made of glass. He's looking inside what is happening. The wife enters the chambers of the king. The king, the minute he saw her, she's so beautiful, he immediately outstretches his hand. I told you he's a pervert. He is a corrupt king. So he outstretches his hand to touch Sarah alayha salatu wasalam. She immediately prays to Allah the Almighty that, Allah, you are my creator, you are my protector. Save me from this evil man. The minute he stretches his hand paralyzes and it falls to the side. Allah's help immediately comes to him. Then he cries out, oh you, you're a magician, you're a witch. Stop it. It is, you're harming me. I won't harm you. Let go of me. Stop this magic of yours. Sarah alayha salatu wasalam, she prays to Allah the Almighty, and then his hand goes back to normal. But his lust, his evil desires does not stop him. He outstretches his hand a second time. The same thing happens. And then a third time, the same thing happens. Until finally he gives up and says, you know what, you are a person full of magic. You are a witch. I can't do you. He scolds the soldiers. Why have you brought a witch into my palace? Get her out of here. And if you leave me, he pleads to her, if you leave me, I will gift you a slave girl. I will gift you a slave girl. Who is this slave girl, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? Hajar alayha salatu wasalam. See, at the beginning, when they came to the border, and when the soldiers captured his wife, it looked a trial. It looked a calamity to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. He wouldn't have understood. But by them passing that trial, that calamity with flying colors, you know who came down the lineage of Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam? Who, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is what's happening behind the scenes. This is what is happening behind the scenes. No one knows. A calamity takes place. A trial takes place. But then there is something greater planned behind it, which you are not aware of. So like I said, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, every single thing that is around us, whether it be positive, whether it be negative, it is a blessing of Allah the Almighty upon us, which we have to thank Allah the Almighty. But remember, even if you were to be in sajda your whole life, you would never be able to thank Allah the Almighty for His blessings. Because His blessings are so vast and so great. But nevertheless, we being the slaves of Allah the Almighty, it is upon us to thank our powerful and beloved Creator. Likewise, He has blessed us with such a beautiful opportunity where we get together often, where we discuss about Allah the Almighty, we discuss about the sayings of His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is another blessing that we have to thank Allah the Almighty. So we thank Allah the Almighty for all the blessings that He has blessed us and bestowed upon us, and we also seek protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the adverse consequences of the evil deeds that we do. As we are perpetual sinners, we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we seek His forgiveness, and we turn to Him in tawbah. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Now last session, that is Dajjal part 1, we discussed many things. And I also told you all in the last session that this session will be focusing on the amazing hadith of Tamim ibn al-Dari radiyallahu anhu. A very amazing hadith. Even myself, as I was preparing for the lecture, I was amazed. And inshallah, you will also be amazed as we go through the hadith. But let's do a small summary about what we actually discussed in the previous session. And that is mostly in regard to the description of Ad-Dajjal. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to refer to Ad-Dajjal as Al-A'war. He used to refer to him as Al-A'war. Because Dajjal, he would be blind in one eye. Like I mentioned in the earlier session, he would be blind in one eye. Scholars go on to mention that one of his eyes will be Ta'ifa and the other eye will be Ta'fiya. With a Hamza and with a Ya. In other words, one of his eyes will be defective and the other eye will be bulging, swollen and floating like a grapefruit in his socket. So his right eye will be blind. And that is the eye which will be floating like a grapefruit in his socket. It will not be in one place, it will be floating around in his socket. His left eye will be defective. You understand? His right eye is blind, his left eye will be defective. Partial sight, but defective. And it would have a thick layer of skin, which would look like green glass covering that eye. It would look like green glass. This is the description given by our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, like I mentioned in the earlier session, some people try to give a figurative expression to Dajjal. Or they think of Dajjal as a metaphor or a symbol of evil. Some people consider Dajjal to be the Freemasons or the Society of the Freemasons. Some people consider Dajjal to be a symbol, so they think technology by itself is Dajjal. Some people say the World Wide Web is Dajjal. Some people say the television is Dajjal. Why? Because it has one big screen which looks like one eye. But all of that can be refuted, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, because the description which our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us about Dajjal is so vivid and so in detail that he cannot be a symbol, he cannot be a figurative expression, but rather he is an individual. He is from the children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. He is from the children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. He is a human being with all of these descriptions attached to him. As we will see when we go further, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam now goes on to mention in regard to his complexion. His complexion would be a ready white. What is ready white? You have white, you have black. You have ready white when the white has a tinge of red in it. Then it's known as ready white. His complexion would be ready white. He would have a protruding forehead. A larger than usual forehead, the Dajjal. And on that forehead, three letters would be written. Kaf, Fa, Ra. In another narration, Kafir, with an alif. One narration says Kaf, Fa, Ra. And another narration, Kafir, would be written on his forehead. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this description, and there are other qualities too, but none of these can be given to the television. Do you have a television which has a protruding forehead? Or the technology having a complexion, ready white complexion, two eyes? No. So from this we understand the hadith is clear. We don't have to go into interpretations. Rather, we can take it from its direct meaning. That it is an individual with all of these qualities. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, regarding what would be written on his forehead, kafir, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say that this statement, even a literate believer or an unlettered or an illiterate believer would be able to read this. would be able to read the statement that is written on the forehead of Dajjal. And you know what is the condition? That believer, whether he be literate or illiterate, if he has iman in his heart, he would be able to read it clearly. Allahu Akbar. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, even if you have an Oxford degree, even if you have the degrees of all over the world, I'm not saying it's haram. Our religion, alhamdulillah, all praise be to Allah, is a very broad religion. It does not want its followers to be mucks or fools. Secular education is highly encouraged. But sadly, today what has happened is, people give so much of importance to secular education. You give so much of importance to your academic careers, your academic degrees, whilst you don't even know how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha properly. Allah save us all. Allah fill our hearts with divine knowledge. My beloved teacher, Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, he says that a slave of Allah has to attach such importance to seeking divine knowledge even more than the importance he attaches to water, food and shelter. Allahu Akbar. Water, food and shelter. Without water, your throats would parch and you would die out of thirst. Without food, you would die out of starvation. Without shelter, you would not be able to protect yourself from the heat and the rain. But Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says that a real slave of Allah would attach even more than that importance to seeking divine knowledge. Knowledge in regard to the Quran and the ahadith, the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For many a time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we see scholars, Salafun as-Salih, our pious predecessors, they wouldn't get food for days, but they would be in the circles of knowledge, learning knowledge, imparting knowledge. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, many a time his breakfast or perhaps his whole day meal would be dry leaves which he used to dip into the river and eat. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. This used to be their life. Imam Nawawi, rahimahullah, it was once asked, a student of his asked him once, "Oh great Imam, how come you have not married?" And you know what his reply was? "Oh, you know what? I forgot to marry. This was his reply. And it wasn't a joke. He was serious. And we understand this because he's a giant, a scholar. He has written encyclopedias. The book Al-Majmu' Sharh Al-Muhadhab, a huge book about the madhab of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, discussing so many aspects of fiqh, was written by Al-Imam Nawawi rahimahullah. Such a great scholar, they did not have time to even sit down for a proper meal and eat bread with two or three curries. Rather, they used to dip the bread in water and swallow it, saying that even the time that we take to chew the food is important for us. Important for us. They used to spend their whole lives learning, teaching, imparting their knowledge. But on the other hand, we leave alone attaching importance to divine knowledge, we waste so much of our time. So much of our time. Time is precious, extremely valuable. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we need to attach dire importance to divine knowledge. Just as how you study your secular education, you need to have an attached importance to seeking knowledge, divine knowledge in regard to the Quran and the hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Priority should always be given to divine knowledge. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not talking about secular education. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not talking about your degrees or your business management degrees. Like I said again, it is not haram, it is encouraged. But the hadith refers to divine knowledge. In regard to your salah, in regard to perfecting your salah, your divine link with your creator, in regard to reading the speech of our beloved creator. All of this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And don't think that the sciences of Islam are few. Scholars have to study for 10, 15 years to master the sciences of Islam. For you to understand the Quran, The Arabic language alone is not enough. You have to study classical Arabic. You have to study balagha. You have to study grammar. You have to study logic, rhetoric. All of these are sciences. And if you talk about the hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are so many sciences in regard to it. As how you clarify whether the hadith is authentic or not authentic, whether it is weak, whether it is hasan. And in regard to the biographies of the narrators of the ahadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have usulul fiqh, the principles of jurisprudence on how you derive rulings from the Quran and the hadith. You have usulul hadith, you have principles in regard to the hadith, how you understand the ahadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have tafsir in regard to the Quran. There are so many sciences where we can immerse ourselves. It is a deep ocean. A deep ocean, where no one has reached the bottom. No one. Any scholar all around the world, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, each time he opens the noble Quran, he can come out with a new jewel, a new pearl. Allahu Akbar. It is a deep and vast ocean. I'm just trying to instill the importance of seeking knowledge in your hearts, where you have to try, to seek more and more knowledge. For the more knowledge you seek, divine knowledge, the more closer you get to your Creator. The more you study about His names and attributes, the more you understand His greatness, His Jalala. The more Iman instills in your heart. Iman is grounded in your heart. And through that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you become a strong mu'min, an intelligent mu'min, who understands his enemy, the traps of his enemy. And likewise, once Iman is grounded in your heart, you would be able to read what will be written on the forehead of Dajjal, and immediately by a mere glance you would be able to identify the culprit. But if you don't have Iman, you will be dazzled by what Dajjal would do. You will be dazzled. As we go on, we'll discuss on how, at what a time Dajjal will come in. He's not going to come at a time when everything is going to be beautiful and rosy. We'll discuss that as we go further. So, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, another point to be highlighted in regard to reading what would be written on the forehead of Dajjal. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu narrates this hadith, and it is in Bukhari and Muslim, authentic hadith. Anna Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ صِيَاحَ الدِّيكَ فَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Allahu Akbar. If you hear the rooster, you know the rooster? If you hear the rooster crowing, you know, early in the morning it crows, and during the day also it crows. But in, it's a sad thing that in Colombo I don't think you have roosters, but if you go to the, maybe we have roosters on our alarm clocks, but not in reality. So if you go to the village, you have roosters. If you hear the rooster crowing, then immediately seek Allah's bounty. Seek Allah's bounty. فَإِنَّهَا رَأَتْ مَلَكًا. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because that rooster is crowing because it has seen an angel. It has seen an angel. So immediately seek the bounty of Allah. Likewise, the hadith goes on. وَإِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ نَهِيقَ الْحِمَارِ فَتَعَوَّذُوا بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ فَإِنَّهُ رَآ شَيْطَانًا. If you hear the donkey brain, then immediately seek refuge in Allah the Almighty from the accursed shaitan. Why? Because that donkey is braying because it has seen shaitan in reality. Not a fairy tale, not to amuse you all. Hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. The words of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He who وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. He does not speak out of his own desires. He does not speak out of his pocket. Not fairy tales. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Whatever he speaks is divine inspiration from Allah the Almighty. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if animals can see angels and shaitan, today science confirms that each animal's sight differs. You have the bees. The bees, they can look directly at the sun, because their eyesight, their faculty of sight has been engineered in such a manner by our beloved maker that they can see UV rays, ultraviolet rays. None of us, we can't look at the sun directly. Our eyes have not been created in such a manner, but the bees can. You take the owl. You know the owl? The owl is blind in the morning, but at night, it has night vision. Night vision goggles. It can look around and it can see the rats scurrying away in the forest and can attack it immediately. It has night vision. So Allah the Almighty has created animals in different forms and shapes. And in that way their faculties are also different. So if animals can see shaitan, if animals can see malaika, if animals have, you know, the dog, its sight is black and white. Everything is black and white. No color. So it's not surprising that Allah the Almighty would bless us with the power to read what would be written on the forehead of Dajjal. Huh? And the people who do not have Iman, it would be just a normal forehead for them. It would be a normal forehead for them. They would not be able to identify the three letters that would be written on the forehead of Dajjal. This is the importance of Iman. And this is the importance of seeking knowledge and knowing things in regard to all of this. So we go on. Now Dajjal, he would have a wide neck. He would have a wide neck. And when you say wide neck, I think everybody is wondering, how can it be a wide neck? You know, I think the brothers who go to the gym would understand. Once you work out, you know, you have traps here, traps. They call them traps. The guys who go to the gym would know. You work out your traps, you do your shoulder exercises, what happens? The traps become big. And then when they flex, he looks as if he's got a wide neck. So Dajjal would be powerfully built. He would have a broad chest. He would be slightly hunched. And he would have a wide neck. Because of his powerful build. He would walk, his feet set apart. This is how the bodybuilders walk. He would walk like this. With his feet set apart. This is how Dajjal would walk. He would be short. Not funny. He would be short. He would be stout. He would be powerfully built. Broad chest, wide neck. And he would walk with his feet set apart. He would have curly locks of hair which would look like serpents tangled with one another. Curly locks of hair which would look like serpents. If you look from afar, it would look like serpents, you know, intertwined upon one another. He will be sterile. He will not have children. Dajjal, he will not have children. Just as how we discussed in the previous session, the hadith of Ibn Sayyad. If I open up that hadith now, the whole session would go. But in that, there was a point where Ibn Sayyad, he says that I'm traveling from Makkah to Medina. That proves that I'm not Dajjal. And likewise, I've left my children back in Medina and I'm traveling to Makkah. The brothers who came last session, they would know. So that he proves by that saying that I'm not Dajjal. But we already discussed the opinions of the scholars in regard to Ibn Sayyad. Funny character. Let's leave it at that. Now the other hadith, we mentioned it in the previous session too. Ibn Umar radiallahu an, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once said that whilst I was sleeping, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that once whilst I was sleeping, I saw a dream. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw a dream. Allahu Akbar. He saw a dream and he says, in that dream, I saw myself performing tawaf around the Kaaba. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw a dream and in that dream, he saw himself performing tawaf around the Kaaba. You see, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we can talk about different issues. But why I highlighted Iman and knowledge is because we're living in a time, I mentioned this in the previous session, as I was preparing for the talk of Dajjal, and also I have done a talk in regard to the signs of Qiyamah. When I was preparing for it, most of the minor signs have already taken place. Allah save us all. Most of the minor signs. The only thing that is remaining are the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. Dajjal is one of the major signs. And in the previous session we discussed about the 10 major signs. Dajjal is one of the signs. But the scary part is the hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says that the major signs, there is no order. They are like a necklace with beads. If one bead falls, the remaining beads will fall one after the other, consecutively, one after the other. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you can't say, okay, the first major sign has taken place, you know, we have time to chill, chillax, we have time to relax and chillax, you know, we've got another 9 signs remaining. No. Even if one of it were to occur, the remaining would occur one after the other. And if we do not have Iman at that time, we would sway, like sticks in the mud. If we do not have knowledge in regard to all of these fitnas, in regard to all of these trials, we would not be able to identify them. We would fall into the pits of shaitan. Allah save us all. Allah save us all. So it is important that we discuss about these things. It is important that we be attentive. That we be attentive. I'm happy to see the brothers who are making notes. Or else you have the recording, you have the audio recording, the video recording. Try and internalize all of these things. Don't come to fascinate yourself, amuse yourself. No. Come to get a deep understanding in regard to these things so that if these trials break out, you would be able to identify the judge. You would be able to identify all of the other signs and save yourself before the sun rises from the west. Allahu Akbar. For we know the minute the sun rises from the west, the door of tawbah is shut. Now you can go after the lecture and go and make tawbah to Allah the Almighty. He will accept your tawbah. But the minute the sun rises from the west, there is no chance whatsoever to seek tawbah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the tawwabin, the sincere repenters. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now in regard to the dream, he says that he saw himself performing tawaf around the Kaaba, and then he says, I saw a dark man, a man with a dark complexion, not very dark, but a dark complexion, with straight hair, standing between two men. Water was dripping from his head. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now he asks in the dream, who is this? Man hada? And it was said to him, he is the son of Maryam, alayhi salatu wa sallam. He is Isa, alayhi salatu wa sallam. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he turned, and he saw a ruddy complexioned man, well built, with curly hair, blind in his right eye, and the other eye floating like a grape. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then asked, who is this man? And it was replied, it was said to him, that he is a Dajjal. He is a Dajjal. And then a fine point in the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then says, that a Dajjal, the person I saw in the dream, he looked exactly like Abdul Uzza ibn Qatan. Abdul Uzza ibn Qatan. Now this hadith is in Bukhari. And Ibn Qatan, he was a man from the tribe of Banu Mustalaq, from the Khuza'a clan. Okay? So this hadith, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, highlights something once again. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he do? He said he resembled Ibn Qatan. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself is highlighting that it is going to be a human being. It is going to be from the children of Adam. It is not a symbol of evil. It is not a figurative expression. It is not a metaphor. You can't interpret Dajjal to be some movement, some society. No, he is a human being from the children of Adam with all of these specified qualities attached to him. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, like I mentioned in the beginning, Dajjal, he will not emerge when everything would be rosy, when everything would be nice and beautiful. No. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarifies that a time would come. The time would be filled with trials. It would be filled with calamities. So much to the extent that three specific years will come upon this ummah. Three specific years. In the first year from that 3 years, Allah the Almighty would hold back 1/3 of the rain. 1/3 of the water coming from the heavens would be stopped. And 1/3 of the cultivation, the vegetation, plants would be held back the first year. On the second year, 2/3 will be held back. 2/3 of the rain will be held back. 2/3 of the cultivation would be held back. And the final year, not a drop of water would fall. And not one plant would grow. Every single thing would be barren. It would be as if a desert. It would be starvation. People would be starving. Famine everywhere. Drought. No plants. No food. And it is at this time that the Dajjal would emerge. He would come out. It is a time people are starving. People are hungry. People are looking for food. No food. No rain. No water. And it is at this time, Dajjal, at the peak of this time, Dajjal would come out. Dajjal would come out. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you see, when a person is hungry, you see many a time these missionaries, what do they do when they come? When they come, they immediately target the poor, the people who are afflicted with dire poverty. The minute they give them food, the minute they give them aid, money, they easily convert them to their religion. Because a person stricken with poverty, hardship, calamities, his beloved ones are suffering from diseases, somebody comes and helps, he is willing to listen. So it's not going to be at a time when we are going in our good cars and living in our palaces that the Dajjal would come. Famine and destruction would hit this ummah. And at this time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the Dajjal would come out. And when he comes, he will come out from a land from the east, from the far east. The Dajjal, he would come out from a land from the east. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us that the Dajjal will emerge from a land in the east called Khurasan. Dajjal will come out from a land in the east called Khurasan. And this hadith is in Tirmidhi, classed Sahih by Imam Albani rahimahullah. Anas radiallahu anhu narrates another hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that the Dajjal will emerge from amongst the Jews of Isfahan. The Dajjal would come out from amongst the Jews of Isfahan. Some scholars say that Isfahan, part of Persia. Okay? And most of his followers would be Jews. The hadith goes on, and he would have with him 70,000 Jews following him. 70,000 Jews following him. All of them would be wearing crowns. All of them would be wearing crowns. And this hadith is in Ahmad. And according to the earlier hadith which I narrated, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say that the people who would follow Dajjal, their faces would be like flattened shields. You know, you have shields that you use for war, like flattened shields. In other words, have you seen a shield, a round shield? When it's flattened, what happens? The part goes in. Faces, scholars go on to mention that this description matches perfectly the people from the Far East. No offense to the Chinese, but they're talking about people who look like Chinese. People who look like Chinese. It's just a description. We're not saying that the Chinese are going to follow them. Now please, any Chinese watching the video, don't get angry. You never know. So they say that the description matches the people of the Far East. Chinese, Mongolians, Persians, and also, some time back, there was a great war between the Tatars. Tatars. They were from Russia. And the scholars of that time, they thought that they were the Jews who were going to follow the Dajjal, because their faces were also as such. And they caused great corruption on the face of this earth. They were all destroyed. Anyway, the description given to the people who would follow the Dajjal is that their faces would look like flattened shields. And many scholars mention that they match the description of the people from the Far East. From the Far East. Okay. Now we go on to the hadith of Nawas ibn Sam'an, radiallahu an, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talks a great deal about the Dajjal in the hadith. And then Rasulullah, the hadith is in Muslim. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say that this, that a Dajjal, he would rule, that from the day he emerges, he would rule for 40 days. For 40 days. The Dajjal would rule for 40 days. And when the Dajjal comes out, now I told you, he will come out at a time, starvation, drought, famine, everything has struck, you know, is common amongst the ummah. The Dajjal comes out at this time, and he would have mountains of bread, mountains of meat, mountains of provision. This is how the Dajjal would come out. And he would come, he would start dazzling the people. People are starving. People want food. And he comes with mountains of bread, mountains of meat. The Dajjal. He would come, he would look at the earth. He would look at a place which would be like ruins. And he would say, oh, treasures come out. Now all of this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we need to clarify something. The Dajjal has no power. Dajjal has no power. Allah the Almighty, it is through His decree, it is through His will, it is a trial, it is a test to see which of the believers pass with flying colors. And this is an exam, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. The questions have already been given to you. The answers have already been given to you. What an easy examination. You know all about Dajjal. Dajjal is going to come and this is his description. So it is only left to us to pass with flying colors. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the fitna of Dajjal. So he would look at a place which would be ruins and say, "Oh, treasures come out." And Allah the Almighty would have given him that power where the treasures would come out and start following him, start swarming around him like bees. All the treasures, gold, silver, platinum, you name it, all of the precious metals, all of the jewels, gems, all would come out and start, you know, swarming him. The people would be dazzled, they would be amazed. Who is this man? He's come with so much of food, we're starving, and he has so much of treasures with him, gold, silver. How is this possible? And then in that very hadith, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to clarify in regard to those 40 days, the first day from those 40 days would be like 1 year. The first day, 365 days, the first day, the duration of the first day. The second day would be like 1 month, the second day. The third day would be like 1 week. Like 1 week. And then from there onwards, the remaining days would go as usual, 24-hour days. 24-hour days. So, does that worry you all in any way? Any doubts that you need to clarify? Okay. The Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, the minute they heard the hadith, the first question that they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulullah, how are we to pray on such a day? How are we to pray on such a day?" This is what I was trying to highlight. How are we to pray on such a day? You see, this was their worry. This was their worry. Salah. Nothing else. They knew that the minute your salah is perfect, your divine, your link with your divine creator is perfect, you don't have to worry about the Dajjal. You would be able to face the Dajjal and you would be able to pass the test of the Dajjal with flying colors. They asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when this day comes upon us, the day, the duration would be 1 year, 365 days, how are we to pray? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explains, he clarifies, on that day, you would have to estimate time and pray accordingly. Now how would the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhim ajma'in estimate time if that day is going to be the duration of 365 days? How did they monitor time? They used to place a stick in the ground and follow the shadow. But if the sun is never going to set on that day, how are they going to estimate time? So scholars mention that this is one of the things that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was inspired by Allah the Almighty. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is highlighting that this time, this calamity would come at a time when my ummah would be able to record time accurately. Today we have Salah 4:52. You have Asr 3:17. 3:22, Maghrib 5:56. Accurate. This was not the case at the time of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. For scholars mention that this one day would be one whole day. The sun would not set. 365 days, the duration would be one day. So if that's going to be the case, how are you to estimate time? How are you to estimate time? How would the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhim ajma'in estimate time? It's impossible. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is clarifying that the Dajjal would come at a time when my ummah would be able to accurately record time. Today we can see, we can estimate time. We have the prayer times, we have our watches with us. So even if such a day comes upon us, We have to estimate time and make salah. There's no excuse. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Dajjal would come out at a time when all the peoples, their faith would be battered. Their faith would be battered because starvation, hunger, poverty, calamities have afflicted them. Their faith would be battered, and this is the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests the faith of the true believers with the calamity of Dajjal. Now when Dajjal comes out, like I said, he would do all of these things and dazzle the people. Now what happens is everything is happening in front of your eyes. Everything is manifesting in front of your eyes. Now all of this time we believe in the ghaib. We believe in al-ghaib. We haven't seen Allah the Almighty. We haven't seen our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we believe. Mu'minun. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. This book, there is no doubt in it. هُدَلْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Guidance for the people of taqwa. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Allah goes on to describe them that they are the ones who believe in the ghaib. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. And they establish salah. So, like I said, now when this person comes out, when Dajjal comes out and starts doing everything in front of them, everything is manifesting in front of them, they start to sway. Their tendencies start turning towards him. Why? Because he's bringing food. He's bringing treasures out from the ground. He will enter a city. He will enter all of the cities on the face of this earth, except Makkah and Medina. And there's another hadith which mentions four locations. We'll discuss that as we go. But in general, he would enter a city, and now the city is barren. They don't have food like we discussed. He will cause rain to fall with the decree of Allah. He would cause the trees to bloom. Fruits will ripen. People would start seeing their animals, their udders filling up with milk. Everything would look beautiful. And then he would call them to worship him, saying that I am Allah. That I am Allah. That you worship me. And if that town or city, locality, vicinity, they deny him, he walks out and everything goes back to chaos. Everything goes back to destruction. Rain would stop, the plants would stop blooming, and everything would become barren again. So the people hearing about it, they would know, oh, an individual is coming like this. If we believe in him, everything will be good. If we deny him, we are going to suffer. So due to that, his followers will start increasing. City after city, he will start traveling. People will start believing in him. He will have two rivers. He will have two rivers. One narration says that he will have paradise. He will have heaven in one hand and Jannah in the other. He will have heaven and he will have Jannah and Jahannam. He will have heaven and hell. But in reality, his hell would be heaven and his heaven would be hell. You understand? His heaven would be hell and his hell would be heaven. You understand? Likewise, he would have two rivers. Two rivers, one of which would be molten lava, liquid fire, molten lava. And the other river would be cool water. But in reality, the molten lava would be cool water, and the cool water would be molten lava. As we go on, we'll discuss where he would kill a man and bring him back to life and put him into the river. We'll go on and discuss that hadith. Then what he would do is, he will call a man who is brimming with youth, a youngster, just like all of us, a young boy. He would call him, he would strike him with his sword. He would strike him with his sword, cut him into two pieces. He would walk in between the two pieces, and some narrations say that he would go to the distance of an archer from his target. You know the bow and arrow, how far you would go to shoot your bow and arrow. Dajjal would go to that distance, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarifies, and then he would call that youngster who he just chopped, and the young man will get up and come walking to him smiling. Smiling. This would be another sign of his trying to prove that he is God. So like I said, he will enter every city except for Makkah and Medina. The reason being, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarifies in the same hadith, if I'm not mistaken, Nawas ibn Sam'an, that there would be angels around Makkah and Medina brandishing their swords. There would be angels protecting Makkah and Medina brandishing their swords. So Dajjal would not be able to enter Makkah and Medina. And in another narration, Junada ibn Umayyah al-Azdi, he says that I came to a man from amongst the companions of the Prophet Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in and said to him, Ya Rajul, O man, tell me a hadith that you heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the Dajjal. And then he mentioned the hadith and he said that Dajjal, Rasulullah, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that Dajjal would stay amongst you all for 40 days, during which he will go to every city. Dajjal would go to every city on the face of this earth except for four masajid. Four masajid. Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, and then the Masjid al-Nabawi from in Madinat al-Munawwara, and the Masjid of Sinai. The Masjid of Sinai. And the Masjid al-Aqsa. Four locations. Four locations Dajjal would not be able to enter. But the more authentic narration, according to most of the scholars, is the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlights that he would not be able to enter Mecca and Medina. This is the opinion of the majority of the scholars. And then there's another incident that would take place. He would go to the outskirts of Medina. The outskirts of Medina. And now, like I said, he can't enter Medina. He can't enter Medina because the angels protecting Mecca and Medina. He would go to the outskirts of Medina and three earthquakes will take place. Three earthquakes will take place. And the minute these earthquakes take place, all the kuffar, all the munafiqun who would be in Medina would come out and join him. Now a question could arise. How come kuffar and munafiqun in Medina? Possible or not? Scholars go on to clarify that by you saying kuffar, they will only be Muslim by name. And also nifaq would be in their hearts. They would not be real Muslimun. So all of them, they would easily sway towards Dajjal and become his followers. All of them would leave and only the true believers would remain in Mecca and Medina. And also another thing to be highlighted is most of the followers of Dajjal will be women. Most of the followers of Dajjal will be women. It was reported that Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that Dajjal would come to a pond close to a valley in Medina. And most of those who will go out to him will be women. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to clarify that it will be such a scary situation that so much of women would go and join him that it would be until a man will come home to his mother-in-law, his mother, his daughter, his sister, his aunt, and he would tie them up strongly, fearing that they also might go and join Dajjal. Hadith is in Ahmad. So much women would go and join Dajjal. Scholars mention the reason being that women are easily swayed. Easily swayed. So if they do not have strong iman to hold them down and the knowledge about Dajjal, they would be easily swayed by his dazzling feats and go join him. So the hadith of Umama al-Bahili radiallahu an also highlights another point that Dajjal, he would bring back to life a person's, an individual's parents. He would call an individual and mostly from the Bedouins. Why? Because the Bedouins, they don't have much knowledge in regard to Dajjal. They are people cut off from society, living in the villages, not seeking knowledge. So they would not be aware of what Dajjal would do. He would call one of them and ask that person, would you believe in me if I bring your parents back to life? To which he would not reply at times, or perhaps he would reply saying yes. And then what a Dajjal would do is, he would call two jinnat, two devils, to impersonate that individual's parents. And scholars go on to mention, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, each person, like I mentioned in the lecture, Belief in the Unseen, each person has a qareen, has an evil companion, a qareen from the jinnat. Every human being has a qareen, an evil jinn companion. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this hadith, Aisha radiallahu anha, she was once with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was staying in her house. She suddenly woke up and started searching for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She started searching for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know Aisha radiallahu anha, very young, and mashallah, through her so many rulings, a great scholar of Islam, she brought about, due to her inquisitiveness and the way she asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam things, she brought so many things to light. So she was searching for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, trying to feel for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was missing. He was not next to her. So she gets up and rushes to see where he is. She thinks that he might have gone to another wife's house perhaps. She was young. So she's looking for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The houses are not big, not palaces. She stumbles upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wives, in reality, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in salah. He was praying. So the minute she stumbles upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked her, Ya Aisha radiallahu anha, has your evil qareen come to you? He asked her, has your evil qareen come to you to disturb you, to put doubts? Because this evil qareen, he puts suspicion, waswas, doubts in your mind. To which she's shocked and she asks, has everyone got an evil qareen? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, yes, of course. And now we understand through this question, see how much of knowledge she brings about. She asked, and she is the only person who would dare ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam such a question. She asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then what about your evil qareen, ya Rasulullah? She is the wife of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So she asks. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then clarifies, yes, even I have got an evil qareen. But Allah the Almighty gave me the power to overcome him and change him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was blessed with the power to overcome the evil qareen and change him to the better. So, now coming back to what Ad-Dajjal would do, some scholars say that he would call the qareen, because the qareen is the one who knows you in and out. He follows you everywhere. He knows your likings, your desires, the way you speak, the way you do things, the way you talk. So he brings about these two qareen, or perhaps he would call another two jinnat who would know about the individual's parents to impersonate them, to look like them. And you know what they would do? They would come like that person's parents and say, oh my son. Now suddenly, you know what? You see, if you just call a random person who has lost his mom and dad, and you tell him, you know what, I'm going to bring your mom and dad back. He's going to be intrigued and he wants to know why, because it's his parents. And then in reality, when his parents come walking, he's going to get the shock of his life. And then not only that, the hadith goes on to say that they would come and say, Oh my son, follow this man, for he is your Lord. Follow this man, for he is your Lord. This is the trials. You see the trials in regard to Ad-Dajjal. And the man would have no option. My parents are coming and telling me that he, of course, they have gone to the world of the dead and they have come back now. They have seen everything and come back. Has any one of us gone to the world of the dead and come back? To come and say, you know what, the qabr was like a 5-star room and you know this was this and this was that. No. No one knows what happens in the realm of the dead. No one. So now if these two parents come back to life and they're coming and telling me that he is my Lord, then I've got to believe them. And he sways. He follows the Dajjal. Hadith in Ibn Majah, class Sahih by Imam Al-Bani rahimahullah. Now in regard to the narration where he would kill a young man. See, I keep highlighting young man. The reason being, this man, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is considered, will be considered to be the greatest martyr in the sight of Allah the Almighty. A youngster like you and me. A youngster. And look at the strength of his iman. Hadith is in Bukhari, narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, says that this person whom Dajjal would kill, he would be one of the best of people. In other words, he would be closely connected to the masajid. He would be praying to Allah the Almighty, a pious and righteous young man. So, he would be one of the best of the people who would go out from the city, go straight to Dajjal. He would go confidently, strongly, go to Dajjal. And this man will come out from the city of Medina. He will go straight to Dajjal and he will say to Dajjal, I bear witness that you are the Dajjal whom our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us about, told us about. Then Dajjal would be upset. someone coming up to his face and saying such a thing. He would look around at his followers, the 70,000 followers and now all of his new following where he has collected all over the place. He would look at them and say, what do you think if I kill this man and bring him back to life, then will you all have any doubts about me? Then they will immediately say, no. Now they want to see a magic show. They want to see a miracle taking place in front of them. So they say, no, we will never disbelieve you afterwards. So then what he would do is, he would kill him. He would kill him and then immediately bring him back to life. He would kill him and immediately bring him back to life. And once again, this is all through the decree and the will of Allah the Almighty. Ad-Dajjal has no power whatsoever. The minute he brings him back to life, as the man gets up, the young man, as he gets up, he says, Wallahi, by Allah, now I am even more sure that you are the Dajjal. That you are the Dajjal. Because this was mentioned to him, he knows about the hadith that the Dajjal would kill the man and bring him back. Now I'm even more sure that you are the Dajjal. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about all of this. That you would come, you would kill a man and bring him back to life. So I'm even more sure that you are the Dajjal. Dajjal would become furious, angry, and he would try to kill him for a second time, where it would not be possible for him to kill him. He would get so angry, what he would do is, he would take the man and throw him into the river of lava. I told you he has two rivers, one lava, one cool water. He has Jannah, he has Jahannam. But in reality, his Jannah is Jahannam, his Jahannam is Jannah. His cool water is lava, his lava is cool water. He throws the man into the lava, and the people around him see that the man, you put someone into lava, what would happen? He would dissolve, nothing would remain. So the man immediately dissolves, and they all think, okay, he's destroyed, he's gone. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam clarifies that that young man has made his path so easy to Jannah. Allahu Akbar. He goes immediately to Jannah. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam clarifies that he would be the greatest martyr in the sight of Allah the Almighty, for confidently standing up to falsehood, to batil, going and, saying the haq in front of the batil. He did not cover, he did not hide, but he was sure of himself, he was sure of his knowledge, he was sure of his iman. He knew that he would not sway, he would not waver towards the Dajjal. He goes and tells it to his face. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the Dajjal alive? Anybody?
He is much alive.
He is.
Lord Muhammad Dari gave a very clear evidence and story.
True.
Who he is, and he first met Jassasa.
Yes. Jassasa. We're gonna discuss the hadith now. So like uncle said, Dajjal is alive. Dajjal is already alive. He is, like I mentioned in the previous session, and I also gave you a trailer about the hadith, he is in a remote island. And now we move to the famous hadith, a very great hadith, which is recorded in Sahih Muslim, authentic hadith. Okay? It is known as Hadithul Jassasa. Hadithul Jassasa. Famous hadith. So, Fatima bint Qais radiallahu anha, she narrates this hadith, famous hadith. She says, سَمِعْتُ نِدَاءَ الْمُنَادِي مُنَادِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُنَادِي أَصَّلَاتَ جَامِعَا. She says that I heard the crier, or the one who announces the announcement of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. نداء المنادي. Before you don't have, or perhaps the muadzin. You don't have a way of getting your message around, a crier, you have a town crier who would go around telling people, shouting the message out. So at that time it was the muadzin generally. He would climb on the minaret and shout whatever it was. And mostly it used to be a salat jami'a. Salah is going to be held in congregation. Then all the people would rush to the masjid, and if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had something important to say, he would announce it to the people. So the minute she heard the crier crying out, As-salata jamia, فَخَرَجْتُ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ فَصَلَّيْتُ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. She says, I went to the masjid and I prayed behind Rasulullah صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. فَكُنْتُ فِي صَفِّ النِّسَاءِ الَّتِي تَلِي ظُهُورَ الْقَوْمِ. And I was, she's a woman, Fatima bint Qais. She's a woman. She's the one who's narrated in the hadith. She says, I was in the saf. Okay. You see, generally you have the men in front and then the women behind in the masjid of Bilal, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So she says, I was in the first row. In other words, the row right behind the row of the men. I was in the first row, the row right behind the row of the men. And then she says, so now what she's trying to emphasize is, by me being there, I had a clear view of the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So listen to me now carefully. She says, فَلَمَّا قَضَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ سَلَّى عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ صَلَاتَهُ جَلَسَ عَلَى الْمِنْبَرِ وَهُوَ يَضْحَكُ. The minute Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concluded his salah, the minute he finished his salah, he sat upon the minbar, upon the pulpit, وَهُوَ يَضْحَكُ. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was smiling. Allahu Akbar. How lucky are they to see our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiling. He was smiling and he says, لِيَلْزَمْ كُلُّ إِنسَانٍ مُصَلَّانٍ. Let every man be in the place of his salah. Let them all be where they are. And then he says, أَتَدْرُونَ لِمَ جَمَعْتُكُمْ. Do you all know why I gathered all of you all? قَالُوا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ عَالَمْ. Allah and His Messenger know best as to why you called us. قال, then he says, إِنِّي وَاللَّهِ مَا جَمَعْتُكُمْ لِرَغْبَةٍ وَلَا لِرَهْبَةٍ وَلَكِنْ جَمَعْتُكُمْ لِأَنَّ تَمِيمًا الدَّارِي كَانَ رَجُلًا نَصْرَانِيًّا فَجَاءَ فَبَايَعَ وَأَسْلَمَ. I did not call you all for some small petty issue, but rather I called you all because Tamim al-Dari رضي الله عنه, a Christian, a former Christian, he has come to me, pledged the oath by me, and he has accepted Islam. Allahu Akbar. وَحَدَّثَنِي حَدِيثًا وَافَقَ الَّذِي كُنْتُ أُحَدِّثُكُمْ عَنْ مَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. And he is telling me a story. He's telling me a narrative that matches whatever I have told you about the Dajjal. So, حَدَّثَنِي أَنَّهُ رَكِبَ فِي سَفِينَةٍ بَحْرِيَةٍ مَعَ ثَلَاثِينَ رَجُلًا مِنْ لَخْمٍ وَجُذَامٍ. He tells me that he undertook a sea journey. He undertook a sea journey with 30 men from Lakhm and Judham, two tribes. 30 men, they undertook a sea journey. Alright? And he goes on to say, فَلَعِبَ بِهِمُ الْمَوْجُ شَهْرًا فِي الْبَحْرِ. They got caught to a storm and the waves played with their ship for a month. For 1 month, they were stranded in the middle of the ocean. ثُمَّ أَرْفَعُوا إِلَى جَزِيرَةٍ فِي الْبَحْرِ. And after 1 month, after a fierce battle with the waves, their ship was shipwrecked on an island, a remote island, they don't know where it is. حَتَّى مَغْرِبِ الشَّمْسِ. The only thing that they know is they could see the sun setting. It was somewhere in the west. It was somewhere in the west. فَجَلَسُوا فِي أَقْرُبِ السَّفِينَةِ. Now they say after the ship was, you know, shipwrecked, what they did was you always have a small boat attached to a huge ship. They get into this Akrubis Safina is the small boat. They get into this boat and they want to go and explore this island. Perhaps there could be fruits, there could be animals that they could hunt and eat. They were stranded in the ocean for a month. So they travel to this island. They travel to this island and he goes on to say, فَدَخَلُوا الْجَزِيرَ. They enter the island. The minute they enter the island, فَلَقِيَتْهُمْ دَابَّةٌ أَهْلَبْ. An animal meets them. An animal, أَهْلَبْ. An animal, a very furry animal, full of fur all over the place. And so much to the extent, لَا يَدْرُونَ مَا قُبْلُهُ مِنْ دُبُرِهِ. They could not differentiate the head from the tail. The animal was one big ball of fur. One big ball of fur. They could not identify the head from the tail. They were upset because they had never seen such an animal. فَقَالُوا وَيْلَكِ مَا أَنْتِ. Woe be unto you, what are you, O animal? And now the animal starts to speak. The animal starts to speak. And it says, أَنَا الْجَسَّاسَ. The animal says, I am جَسَّاسَ. So scholars mention, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, why this animal was known as Al-Jassasa. Al-Jassasa means, in Arabic, the term Al-Jassasa or Jasus means to spy, to eavesdrop. To spy, to eavesdrop. So this animal is known as Al-Jassasa because it is the spy of Ad-Dajjal. It belongs to Al-Dajjal. And it used to go around sniffing for information and things for Dajjal. And that's why it is known as Al-Jassasa. So they asked the animal, "Wama Al-Jassasa? What do you mean you call yourself Jassasa? What is Jassasa?" And then that animal says, "Ayyuha al-qawm, O people, enough of me. Intaliqu ila hadha ar-rajul fi ad-dair, fa innahu ila khabarikum bil ashwaq. Come with me, come with me. I want to take you all to a man who is in that monastery. He wants to meet you. He's very eager to meet you. He's anticipating to meet you." And then he says, "Lamma samat lana rajulan," the minute this animal told us about a man, fear gripped us. This is an island, a remote island, so far away. How come a man is living all alone in that monastery? He has to be some kind of a devil or some kind of a jinn. So they were determined that he has to be a jinn. But nevertheless, they, out of fear, they go behind the animal towards the monastery. فَانْتَلَقَنَا سِرَاعًا حَتَّى دَخَلْنَا الدَّيْرَ. We rushed with the animal and entered the monastery. فَإِذَا فِيهِ أَعْظَمُ إِنسَانٍ رَأَيْنَاهُ قَدْ خَلْقًا. The minute we entered the monastery, we saw a man, a giant, so huge we have not seen a human being in that manner. A huge man. وَأَشَدُّهُ وِثَاقًا مَجْمُوعَةٌ يَدَاهُ إِلَىٰ عُنُقِهِ. His hands were shackled and tied to his neck. His hands were shackled and tied to his neck. مَا بَيْنَ رُكْبَتَيْهِ إِلَىٰ كَعْبَيْهِ بِالْحَدِيدِ. And his legs were also shackled with iron chains. He was tied up in this monastery. فَقُلْنَا وَيْلَكْ مَا أَنْتَ. Woe be unto you, what are you? O man who is shackled and in this monastery. قَالَ قَدْ قَدَرْتُمْ عَلَىٰ خَبَرِي. The man replies, "You have enough of time to get to know about me, but you tell me some things. فَأَخْبِرُونِي مَا أَنْتُمْ. You tell me who are you. You will get to know in due time who I am. You tell me who are you all. نَحْنُ أُنَاسٌ مِّنَ الْعَرَبِ. We are Arabs. We traveled, we undertook a sea journey, and we battled the waves for almost a month because we got caught to a storm and we were shipwrecked on this island. We entered the island, this Jassasa hairy animal came and welcomed us and told us that you are in this monastery and brought us to you." And then they go on to say, so they ask him once again, "Who are you?" But then he doesn't reply, he asks them, "Akhbiruni an nakhli baysan." He tells them, "You know what? You tell me about the Nakhl of Baysan." Baysan is a place in Palestine. He says, "You tell me about the palm, the date palms of Baysan. Tell me about the date palms of Palestine." They say, "An ayyi sha'niha tastakhbir? Why are you asking about the date palms of Baysan? They are fine. They are fine. Why are you asking about them?" He says, "As'alukum an nakhliha hal yuthmir?" I'm asking about the fruits. I'm asking about the dates. Are those date palms giving, bearing fruit? Faqulna, they said, "Of course, na'am. They are. They're bearing fruits nicely and beautifully." Then he goes on to say, "Ama innahu yushiku an la tuthmir?" Know that a time is going to come where those trees will not bear fruit anymore. And then he says, "Akhbiruni an buhayrati tabariya." Tell me about buhayra. Buhayra means bahri sea. Buhayra, a small sea. In other words, a lagoon, a type of a pond. Buhayrati tabariya. Tell me about the lake of Tiberias. A huge, it's like a sea. It's like a sea. You can Google it. Tiberias. The Sea of Galilee, they call it. Tiberias, the Sea of Galilee. Buhayra, tell me about that sea, about that lake. And they ask him, "Why are you asking us about it? What about it?" And then he says, "Ama inna ma'aha yushiku an yadhhab." He says, "You know why I'm asking you about it? Because the waters of that lake are going to recede very soon. It is going to dry up very soon." And then he says, "Akhbiruni an ayni zughar." Tell me about the water spring of Zughar. Zughar is a city located in southern Syria, fi balad al-Sham, in south Syria. And he says, and then they ask him, "Why are you asking about that spring?" He goes on to say, You know about that spring? Now it has so much of water. Water is gushing out of it. People are benefiting out of it. But a time is about to come soon when that spring will dry up. And then he says, أخبروني عن نبي الأميين ما فعل. Tell me about the unlettered prophet. What has he done? Then they say, قد خرج من مكة ونزل يثرب. He has come out from Mecca and now settled in Yathrib. Yathrib is another name for Madinatul Munawwara. He has settled in Medina. So this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, one of the reasons why Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu rushed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If this man from nowhere knows about our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that itself, and he says, Nabi al-Ummiyin, the unlettered Prophet, indicates the truth of the prophethood of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he asked them, أَقَاتَلَهُ الْعَرَبُ? Have the Arabs started fighting with him? They said, yes, they have. And then he asked them, كَيْفَ صَنَعَ بِهِمْ? What has he done with them? And they told him, Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu, the people around him said that these people, the Arabs, they come out to fight, but eventually what happens is they begin to obey him. They come under him. They subdue the Muslims, overcome them. Then he says, قَدْ كَانَ ذَلِكَ? He asked, in reality, has that happened? قُلْنَا نَعَمْ. We said, yes. Then he goes on to say, أَمَا إِنَّ ذَاكَ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ أَن يُطِيعُوهُ. Then it is good for the Arabs to obey this man. And then he says, وَإِنِّي مُخْبِرُكُمْ عَنِّي. Now I am going to tell you all about myself. إِنِّي أَنَا الْمَسِيحُ الدَّجَّالُ. I am الدَّجَّالُ. I am الْمَسِيحُ الدَّجَّالُ. وَإِنِّي أُوشِكُ أَن يُؤْذَنَ لِي فِي الْخُرُوجِ. I am about to be granted permission to emerge. I am about to be granted permission to come out. فَأَخْرُجْ فَأَسِيرَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And I will come out and begin to travel the earth. I will begin to traverse this earth. فَلَا أَدَعْ قَرْيَةً إِلَّا هَبَطْتُهَا فِي أَرْبَعِينَ لَيْلًا. I will traverse this earth for 40 nights. 40 nights. I will not leave one city overturned. I will not leave one city except that I visit that city. غير مكة وطيبة. Except for Mecca and Taiba. He says, except for Mecca and Taiba. These two cities I will not enter. فهما محرمتان. Those two cities have been made haram upon me. I cannot enter these two cities. كلما أردت أن أدخل واحدة أو واحدة منهما. Each time I try to enter one of those two cities, there will be a great angel brandishing a sword who will chase me away. And then he goes on to say, وَإِنَّ عَلَى كُلِّ نَقْبٍ مِّنْهَا مَلَائِكَةً يَحْرُسُونَهَا. And in every gate of those cities, there will be angels protecting and guarding. And then Fatima bint Qais radiallahu anha, she says, قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وطعن بمخصرته في المنبر. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم was standing on the pulpit. He was having his asa in his hand and he struck the minbar with the asa and he said thrice, هذه طيبة هذه طيبة هذه طيبة. This land is Taiba. This land is Taiba. This land is Taiba. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was referring to Al-Madinatul Munawwara. Medina is Taiba. Medina is Taiba. Medina is Taiba. Dajjal will not be able to enter Mecca and Medina, which is Taiba. And then she says, no, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he goes on to say that فَإِنَّهُ أَعْجَبَنِي حَدِيثُ تَمِيمَ أَنَّهُ وَافَقَ الَّذِي كُنْتُ أُحَدِّثُكُمْ عَنْهُ. The hadith of this narration of Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu. Allahu Akbar, what a privilege for Tamim al-Dari that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is narrating his narration. Allahu Akbar. He says that the narration of Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu, I'm amazed by it, that أَنَّهُ وَافَقَ الَّذِي كُنْتُ أُحَدِّثُكُمْ عَنْهُ, that it perfectly coincides with whatever I have informed you all about Dajjal and about Medina and Mecca. أَلَا إِنَّهُ فِي بَحْرِ الشَّامِ أَوْ بَحْرِ الْيَمَنِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then goes on to say that Dajjal la bal min qibal al mashriq, ma huwa min qibal al mashriq, ma huwa min qibal al mashriq. That Dajjal will come from the far east. Dajjal will come from a land from the east. Dajjal would emerge from a land from the east. And then Fatima bint Qais, and also she says that Auma biyadihi lal mashriq, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicates towards the east. He points towards the east and says that he would emerge from a land from the east. And then she says that I was so amazed by this hadith, فَحَفِظْتُ هَذَا مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, that I immediately memorized whatever Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was informing me or informing the congregation. So just one or two points in regard to Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, Al-Imam Al-Shawkani Rahimahullah, the famous Yemeni scholar, Allama Al-Mujtahid, may Allah the Almighty have mercy upon him. He says that there are many ahadith concerning the appearance of Al-Mahdi. There are many ahadith concerning the appearance of Al-Mahdi. Okay? And then he goes on to say that all of those narrations gathered together have reached the level of tawatur. I've already discussed about tawatur, I think, in the previous session. When you say tawatur, it refers to a hadith which has been narrated by so many people through so many chains of narration that it is impossible to deny the authenticity of the narration. Imam al-Shawkani rahimahullah, he says that there are so many ahadith in regard to Imam al-Mahdi that highlight that it is from the beliefs, it is from the aqidah, from the aqaid of the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, it is obligatory to believe in al-Mahdi. And al-Mahdi is not Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. He is not Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And likewise, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, he is not in a tunnel. He hasn't emerged. He is not hiding somewhere. All of that what they claim are false. All of those claims are mostly from the Ithna Ashariya. They are a group from the Shia. They say that Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Askari, an individual who is hiding away in a tunnel, he is Al-Mahdi. But it is wrong. And likewise, Al-Mahdi, according to Christians, is Christ, Jesus Christ, who is coming. Our belief, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is that Imam Al-Mahdi is from the children of Adam, from this ummah. It is mentioned clearly by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah in his book Minhaj al-Sunnah. He says that Al-Imam Mahdi rahimahullah, Al-Imam Mahdi, his name will be Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Al-Imam Mahdi, his name will be Muhammad ibn Abdullah or Ahmad ibn Abdullah. His name will be the same name as our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he will be a righteous man from the descendants of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And likewise, he will be a descendant of Hassan ibn Ali radiallahu anhumah. And he would come even before Dajjal. He would come before Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. He would gather the believers with him. But he would not be the one who would kill Dajjal. Now we move on to the death of Dajjal. The death of Dajjal. Now Dajjal would have conquered many cities, gathered a huge following, so many followers, and he's traversing city after the city. And this is at this time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will descend. And it is mentioned that he will descend close to the eastern minaret in Damascus. He will descend close to the eastern minaret in Damascus, and also scholars mentioned by Masjid al-Aqsa. He would descend by Masjid al-Aqsa. He would come at the time of Fajr Salah. He would come at the time of Fajr Salah, and the believers with Imam al-Mahdi. Ya Allah, make us all from those group, from that group, from the believers, from the congregation of that Imam. They will be behind Imam al-Mahdi about to pray Fajr Salah. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam comes. Imam Mahdi, he would feel the presence of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and move back so that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would be able to conduct the salah. But Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would indicate and push Imam Mahdi back to the musalla, asking him to conduct, saying that let your leader conduct for you. So this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, highlight that even though Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is coming for a second time, does not mean that he would follow his religion. No. He would come and his religion at that time would be Islam. He would follow the religion of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is the reason why he would pray behind Imam al-Mahdi. He would pray behind him. Imam al-Mahdi, he would conduct the salah, and after the salah, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would gather the believers and they would head out close to Masjid al-Aqsa. Now Dajjal, he would begin to approach Masjid al-Aqsa. The minute his eyes lay upon Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, the narration, the words of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam say that he would begin to melt and dissolve like salt. The minute salt hits water, just as how it would dissolve, he would begin to dissolve. And they would meet at a place called Bab al-Lud. Bab al-Lud. This is in Palestine. It's known as the Gate of Lud. They would meet there, and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would kill him with a spear. He would kill him with a spear. And after killing him, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would show the spear to the believers, indicating the blood that he has killed al-Dajjal. And the minute he does that, a fragrance will emit from Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and this fragrance would travel so far until where his eyesight would reach. And any disbeliever that is touched by the fragrance of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would immediately fall dead then and there. And then what would happen is the believers would start to hunt the remaining disbelievers and try to kill them. The rocks and the trees also would cry out, "O Spirit of Allah, O Ruh of Allah," calling towards Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, "There is a Jew hiding behind me. Come and kill him. Come and kill him." In that way, all of the followers of Dajjal would be killed, except for the tree known as Gharqad. This is also mentioned in the hadith, Gharqad. This particular tree, it is known as the box thorn tree. This tree would hide the Jews. And people were mentioning that the Jews have started to grow this tree in huge numbers now, because this tree would be the only tree which would hide the Jew and not give him out, not give his location out. All other rocks and trees would show who the person is hiding behind them, so that the Muslims could come and kill them. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, afterwards what would happen is Ya'juj and Ma'juj would break out. Gog and Magog. They would break out. Allah the Almighty would command Isa alayhi salatu wasalam that this group cannot be annihilated, cannot be destroyed by you and the believers. So you all rush to the Mount of Sinai. Rush to the Mount of Sinai, Tur Sinai. You rush over there and hide yourself, because this group is going to cause much chaos and destruction. They would rush to the mountains, Ya'juj and Ma'juj would cause so much of destruction. They, for example, they would cross by a lake, like the Tiberias Lake for example. The first one of them would cross the lake, and when the last one of them comes by the lake, he would say, "There used to be a huge lake over here." To that extent, they would drink water, kill people, rape, they would commit all the sins, you name it. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, nor the believers would have any power over them, so they would rush to the mountains and hide themselves. Until Isa alayhi salatu wasalam prays to Allah the Almighty to get rid of them. Allah the Almighty would then cause them to die due to some worms eating up by their necks. And all of the Ya'juj and Ma'juj would die. And then what would happen is their corpses, their dead bodies would fill the world, and the stench would be so unbearable that the believers would start suffering. The stink would be so unbearable that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would once again pray to Allah the Almighty, and birds would come and take the corpses of Ya'juj and Ma'juj and throw them away in the far oceans. And then the whole earth will be purified. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and the believers will come down, and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will rule in perfect peace and harmony with justice, no problem whatsoever. The blessings of Allah will descend, barakat, bounties, ni'mat, the life will be perfect and peaceful until Isa alayhi salatu wasalam passes away. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will pass away, and then what would happen is a cool breeze would blow. A cool breeze would blow, which would take away the lives of all of the believers. Everyone would pass away. All the believers will pass away, and finally what would happen is a great fire would emerge, gathering the remaining creation to the place where, which is known as the Mahshar. Afterwards, the day of Qiyamah, the reckoning, the trumpet will be blown, and from there onwards the Qiyamah would start. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this is actually a synopsis in regard to Dajjal, even though it was broken into two parts. There are many things that we could not cover, many details that we could not touch due to the constraint of time. Nevertheless, I hope I have given at least a nutshell to you all, a brief understanding in regard to Dajjal, and I hope I have instilled an eagerness in your heart to know more. To know more. As we discussed in the previous session, the more less that Dajjal is mentioned, the more people forget about Dajjal, the more the scholars don't talk about Dajjal in the pulpits, that is the time when Dajjal will break out and emerge. That is the time when Dajjal will break out and emerge. So try to study, seek divine knowledge, for it is only through Iman and it is only through knowledge of the Quran and the Hadith you will be able to identify these calamities. So may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the trials of Dajjal. And like I mentioned in the previous session, the ways to protect yourself from the fitna of Dajjal, number one, the dua which is recited after tashahud. The dua which is recited after tashahud. After the attahiyat. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min a'adab al-nar, wa min a'adab al-qabr, wa min fitnat al-mahya wal-mamat, wa min fitnat al-masih al-dajjal. This dua has been emphasized a lot. Many of the sahaba, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, they have said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us this dua just as how he taught us a surah from the Quran. And some sahaba, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, used to be so strict that if any one of them forgot the dua, they used to repeat the salah. This much of importance they used to give for that dua. So we should try to recite that dua frequently, for that dua would save us from the fitnas of Dajjal. And likewise, Suratul Kahf, like I mentioned in the previous session, some narrations say the first 10 ayat, other narrations say the last 10 ayat. And it's all the more better if you can memorize the complete surah, because it has many benefits and will save you from the fitna of Dajjal. And likewise, try and recite Suratul Kahf whenever you can, especially on Fridays, and pray to Allah the Almighty that He save you from the fitna of Dajjal. And establish your iman, seek divine knowledge, Allah the Almighty would save you from the fitna of Dajjal. So may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, accept all of our deeds, and unite